Hey, Ryan.
This is Michael. You're up.
Hit the switch.
Let's switch. Let's see if it works. It went out on me. Give a second. There it is. Thank you, Ryan. How wonderful it is. Thank you for that prayer, Seth. How wonderful it is to have a new Christian. It happens not often enough, but when it happens, the angels of heaven rejoice. Christianity is always going to be in the minority, but we can add to that minority one soul at a time. And we did that again this morning. So we are thankful to God and to Christ for the salvation he offers and for our new brother who gladly accepted it. Don't forget we have an elders and men's meeting. That's still going to happen, right? As soon as we're done, immediately following our worship here this evening. So men, please stay for that. This is the second Sunday of September, but the schedule, as I have it, I have my own little schedule that I keep for when I preach what sermons and so forth, as I mentioned before. It's been all messed up because of homecoming, which was at the end of August. Typically, we have a fourth Sunday, which is at the end of each month, where one of our young men speaks. But homecoming threw that, you know, for a loop, and so I spoke, and then Colby spoke last Sunday, on the first Sunday. But normally we have our first Sunday series on the Psalms. We had that on the fourth Sunday. So the fourth Sunday was the first Sunday. The first Sunday was the fourth Sunday. But now we're on the second Sunday, which is the second Sunday. So we're all back to normal, at least with respect to our sermons. And this evening, I'd like us to consider briefly, hopefully, a simple sermon that considers the idea that Christians are priests and what to do with that information as priests of God. What are our responsibilities that we should carry out as the priests of God? So what I want us to do is simply this. I want us to look at the four, and there are probably more, but four functions of the Old Testament priest as handled under the Levitical system, the law of Moses. And then take those four that we're going to consider and find the New Testament application for God's New Testament priest, which is in fact all Christians today. But let's start by just noticing the functions and the duties of the Old Testament priests. And I have just one slide for you to consider. It's crudely drawn, but let's just all go with it. This is, as it is best depicted by me, the area of and around the tabernacle, or later, the temple. There is around it, you see the building here to your left. This is the temple, or tabernacle. But this entire area around it is what's called the outer court. It was to the outer court where only Israelites and proselytized Gentiles who became a part of the family of God were allowed to enter. You weren't allowed to enter those areas, that outer court of the tabernacle. It was, for lack of a better phrase, and maybe not lack of, maybe it's a good phrase, holy ground. You couldn't go there unless you were part of the nation of Israel or an added member to it. In that outer court, there were two principal things, for lack of a better word, that existed there. There was the bronze altar, you see number two on the screen, and then the bronze laver, which is basically just a shallow bowl filled with water, which is number three. Yes, number three on the screen. There was something the priest had to do with respect to those before he was allowed to enter the tabernacle and perform his duties as a priest there. The Hebrew, the general run-of-the-mill Jew, guilty of some ignorant sin. If it wasn't ignorant sin, he was stoned. But if it was just some ignorant sin, an oopsie-daisy, I made a mistake, I've sinned against God, what do I do? Well, what he did was, he took his animal sacrifice, unless he was poor, in which case he was allowed to take a meal offering, a flour, kind of a cake mixture, but typically it was an animal sacrifice. He'd kill the animal sacrifice, deliver it to the priest, who would offer it on the bronze altar, which had fire that originally was sent down from heaven to continuously burn, but after multiple captivities, that fire went out and was replenished by the fire that was inside the tabernacle. But let's not get too thick into the thick of it. The fact of the matter is, they offered the sacrifice on that bronze altar. After that was done, the Hebrew was done. The regular Jew went home, his business was taken care of, but the business of the priest was only just getting started. After he offered the sacrifice on the bronze altar, he then walked about 40 steps to what was called the bronze laver, because he's got to go do his duties as a priest, and he can't do them until he is first washed. There, number three. He has to first be washed, and if he's not washed, he can't do anything for God. If he just tries to mosey out in to the tabernacle or later the temple without washing himself, ceremonially cleansing himself, he would be struck dead. And if not struck dead, he'd be drug out and stoned to death for insubordination against God. So he has to wash himself. Once he washes himself, he goes into the first veil, which separated the temple or tabernacle from the outer court. And there he would find himself into what is called the holy place. Most holy place is beyond the next veil. He's in the holy place, number four on the screen. In that holy place, there are three
keep artifacts that concern his business, his daily business as a priest. First of all, you have a bronze candlestick, or a golden, rather, candlestick. Your Bible might say lampstand, which is a more accurate translation. Persians invented candles about 300 years after this thing came into existence. But the lampstand, also called the menorah, it looked like what you've probably seen on Hanukkah time, the candle that comes up with the candles that go out like that. That was there. It's a big, tall thing about this tall, actually about as tall as this podium, though not as wide. And it was right there. It was the very first thing that he saw when he walked in. He would light those, for lack of a better word, candle. Really, a kerosene lamp is a closer equivalent because that has a cloth wick that burns from oil, and that's what that was. It had a cloth wick, which is made from the robe of the priest who would place it in the oil, which was pure olive oil, which probably was grown at the Mount of Olives in Jerusalem. They would light the oil or light the cloth wick, that it would just burn. And since the veils were always kept shut in the tabernacle, the only light that was in that sanctuary, in that holy place of God, was from that divine artifact that produced its own light. There is symbolism all over the place here. Symbolism is rampant in the Old Testament. But listen, just because it's symbolism doesn't mean it is just symbolism. Just because it's symbolic doesn't mean it's just symbolic. These symbols have meanings. The priest doesn't get to say, well, I don't need to wash myself, it's just symbolic, because then he's struck dead by trying to enter the tabernacle improperly. But once he goes in, he lights the candle. Then he turns to number 7, the bread, the table, which doesn't quite look like that. It was a table completely overlaid with gold with these 12 loaves of bread, two stacks of 6 loaves of unleavened bread that the priest would eat. Whether he's hungry or not, it was a ceremony. It was symbolic for him to eat that because he was eating it, and the bread was even called the showbread, or the bread of presence, or the bread of the face, because it was rested right there in front of the veil where on the Ark of the Covenant God's presence was with the people. In other words, those priests ate the bread in front of God. They ate the bread symbolically with God. But you see, the problem is they ate their bread with that as a divider. They ate their bread with God, but they were separated by the veil. So they couldn't fully commune with God. They had a communion, but it was a limited communion. After they ate the bread, the priest then went over to the altar of incense. Gold, just like everything else in that place was, overlaid with gold, made from shittim wood. He would burn the incense with fire that came from the altar that never ran out of fire outside the tabernacle. He would then light the incense, which is just spices and certain kinds of coals that would fill an aroma which would fill the entire holy place. And he would have to do this, light that aroma, twice a day. Why twice a day? Because he had to make sure that that aroma never left the presence of God, remember, which is in beyond the veil in the most holy place. So that's the functions of the priest. Only the priest, though, the high priest alone could enter into the most holy place, of course, the Ark of the Covenant once a year, and offer the sin offering for all the people, including for himself, but that's another sermon. What you have when you see these functions of the priest are symbolic duties they perform. Symbolic, though they didn't realize they were symbolic, symbolic for us today. Those priests that performed those functions had to perform them to the letter. They couldn't just say, well, it's just symbolism. It's not just symbolism. The priest, if he doesn't eat the bread, is dead. The priest, if he doesn't offer or burn the incense on the altar, dies. The priest, if he doesn't light the candles, dies. He has functions to perform, but those functions, unbeknownst to them, symbolized, alluded to our New Testament age, wherein we as God's priests, 1 Peter 2:9, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a priesthood from royalty, a priesthood from a king who made you a priest, that you should show forth the praises of him that's called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. We are God's priests, all of us. Not the preacher is the priest. All Christians are priests, man and woman. We have functions to perform within the spiritual holy place of God. But before we can do that, there are things we have to do to get into the holy place of God. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. We talked about 4 things that concern the priest. He had to be ceremonially washed. He had to trim the wicks. Oh, I didn't mention that. He had to trim the wicks, because if he didn't, it would smolder and smoke instead of burn. He had to trim the wicks, he had to eat the bread with God, and he had to light the altar of incense. If he doesn't do those things, he dies. If I don't do those things, I die. Now let's talk about those things. We have things to do. We have a responsibility to be washed. We have a responsibility to trim our wicks. We have a responsibility to maintain fellowship and communion with God, and we have a responsibility to offer incense to Him. Let's consider those one by one. Let's start with God's priests trim the wicks. Just like the Old Testament priests had to walk in, first thing they had to do was trim those wicks. Because as I said, if they don't, when they start to light the fire, it just smolders. It just burns with soot and with smoke, and the smoke, not of incense, fills the room, and they're coughing their way through their services. There are things they're supposed to do. They have to burn, or rather trim the wicks before they can light the light. I have to trim the wick and light the light. Now, what is my light? It's not a menorah. It's not, see those up there? I thought of that when I was writing this. It's not those kind of candles. That's not the light that I'm supposed to maintain. That's not the wicks I'm supposed to trim. Look at 2 Corinthians 4, 6 and 7. Paul says, "For God, the same God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us." Paul says, the same God who said, "Let there be light," is the same God who shines a different kind of light in our hearts. What kind of light is it, Paul? It's the light of the knowledge of God. It's the light of the gospel. You see, if you were to take the metaphor, if you were to take the symbol of the lampstand and the wicks are what holds the light. The wicks are what basically holds the torch, not what provides the light, that's the oil. The wicks are what hold the light. I am not just the priest that trims the wicks. I am also the thing which holds the light, as Jesus says, "Let your light so shine that makes it your good works and glorify God which is in heaven." This little light of mine, all around the neighborhood, that sort of thing. I am the wick that holds this light, the light of the gospel of Christ. All Christians who take the gospel to their friends, to their neighbors, to their brothers and sisters, all Christians, every time you see someone on the elevator and you say, "Hey, why don't you come worship with me?" Or you knock on the door of your neighbor and say, over the fence, and you say, "Hey, why don't you come to church with me Sunday?" You are the priest of God. Take the light and hold it. But then he says, trim the wicks which hold the light. Ephesians 5:15. See that you walk circumspectly, the King James says. I've got to trim the wicks. That's me. I've got to trim myself. See that you walk circumspectly. See that you walk circum in a circuit, a circle, spectly, using your spectacles, using your eyes. Walk in a circle, looking at yourself. Examine yourself from all angles to make sure that you're not going to go up in smoke. To make sure that you're not burning soot and not the pure light of the gospel. See that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, which don't do that, but as wise, which do that. Because I need to make sure I'm cleanly and clearly burning the light of the gospel. But I can't produce the light. As Paul says, we have this treasure. We, the apostles, have it in earthen vessels. Paul had it within himself, directly inspired by God. I don't have it like that. I have to study the Word of God. I've got to know the Word of God. Whereas Paul had it beamed into his brain. He had that, but I don't. I've got to listen, not read. I said that this morning. I've got to study the Word of God. I don't like these daily Bible reading guides. I like a daily Bible study guide. You'll get your reading in when you study it. Study your Bible. If all you do is just read your... It's not Harry Potter. You don't just read the book. You have to study the book. That way you learn the book. Reading doesn't provide learning. It's like when you have a test to take. Remember being in school and you had to cram for a test the day after or the day following, so you crammed that night. You spent all night. I remember doing that, preaching school. Spent all night just reading and reading and reading, hoping just to fit it in the short-term memory so that you can take the test, pass it, and then you'll forget it. I did that one time. Next day came, test was canceled. So I had to study. I had to actually study. And I was glad that I did because I learned instead of cram. Don't read your Bible. Study your Bible. Trim the wicks and produce the replenish the oil, in other words, that produces the light. That's the Holy Spirit that inspires your word. Study your Bible. But God's priests have more to do than just with the lampstand. God's priests have more to do than just trimming the wicks. God's priest, number two, eat with God. In the tabernacle, you see behind me, the priest approached the table of bread, which was before or standing in front of the face of God. Now, they didn't see the face of God. They couldn't have direct communion with God because, as I say, the veil separates them. That number 10 on the screen. The veil separated them between God. If they tried to cross that veil, even just peek through, dead. Only the high priest could enter, and he could only enter after stripping off his ceremonial robes to just this plain, simple white robe, after taking off his sandals, only one day a year, only with the blood of the Lamb, only after offering for himself. He has all these things he has to do, but just the regular priest back then couldn't do it, but I can. I, through Christ, Hebrews 4, can approach directly the throne of grace. Another way of saying, the mercy seat, which sat atop the Ark of the Covenant. There's no veil anymore. It's taken away. So when I eat the bread, when I take the Lord's Supper, when I commune with God, it's not limited atonement. It is direct communion, a straightway path between me and God. Matthew 26, 26 through 29, as they were eating, that's the Last Supper of Christ. Jesus took the bread, blessed it, broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said, take, eat, this is my body. It's symbolism, but not just symbolism. He took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, we often stop at verse 28. Verse 29 says, but I say to you, I will not drink henceforth. After this meal, no more meals of this fruit of the vine, until that day when I drink anew with you in my Father's kingdom. He doesn't mean he's going to eat with me, sit down and eat with me in heaven. He means he's going to sit down and eat with me in the kingdom. I'm in the kingdom now, so I'm eating with Christ every time I take that little wafer and break off the cracker, every time I take the little shot of grape juice. Don't discard it. It's not just symbolic. It's symbolic, yes, but it means something. That's the body and blood of Jesus Christ you are communing with without the obstacle of a veil separating you. You go directly to the face of God, approach boldly the throne of grace, but you have to make sure that your relationship with God is right. 1 Corinthians 11, 26 and 27. For as often as you eat this bread, this is Paul quoting again the Lord, as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. Then he says, wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily, King James says, shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. I have met brethren who will say, oh, I'm not worthy to take the Lord's Supper. I have committed these sorts of sins, or this one sin, or all of these sins. I've committed these sins as a Christian, and I'm not worthy to take the Lord's Supper. You've got it all wrong. That is not what that verse says. That's not what that word says. Unworthily refers to how you take it, not you who takes it. If you take it unworthily, if you take it not appreciating the body and the blood of Christ, then you're guilty of sin, the body and blood of Christ. But it's not you that's unworthy. If you're a Christian, you are worthy. He made you worthy by dying for you. When you say you're not worthy, you're saying Jesus died for nothing. He died to make you worthy to worship him. Lord's Supper, prayer, every other act of worship that we perform. Listen, priest, you're worthy. Commune with God. I don't understand why my brethren put up these walls for themselves and then fret that they can't scale the wall. Oh, I'm not worthy, as they erect the wall, to worship God. I'm not worthy to take the Lord's Supper. When you put the wall up, all you have to do is repent of your sin. If that's holding you back, just repent of your sin. And yet my brethren will just rather stew in their sin than just get rid of it. Just get rid of it. Otherwise, you're going to hell. That's a serious thing. Yet my brethren would rather just moan and groan that they're living in sin. I guess so they can keep living in sin and say, well, I can't take the Lord's Supper. Well, you can if you just do it. Commune with God. You're a priest, aren't you? You're expected to. Number three, God's priests offer incense. Not incense like I'm incensed, like anger. Incense like the scented aroma. The Old Testament priests would light some spices, and the smoke and the aroma would fill the tabernacle. And before they left, or maybe replaced by the next priest whose shift was later that day, they would relight it to make sure the aroma constantly filled the tabernacle. There is a direct biblical equivalent. Your Bible specifically says what an equivalency of incense is in its prayer. In fact, it's an Old Testament statement that gets that point across. It's Psalm 141:2, where David says, let my prayer go up as incense. Let my hands be the evening sacrifice. All he's saying is, I can't, as a priest, since I'm not a priest, I can't go to the holy place and burn the incense. I can't, as a priest, perform the services a priest can do, but my prayers can be the incense. My hands that work can do the work of God as a priest. Well, I get to say that as a priest, not wishing I were a priest, but being a priest, my prayers can go up as incense. In fact, Revelation 8, verse 3 and 4, a book loaded with metaphor, but let's not get into that. John writes, another angel came and stood at the altar, having the golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar before the throne. And the smoke of the incense, which came up with the prayers of the saints, ascended up before God out of the angel's hands. What about you, priest? Do you offer your incense? They did it twice daily, but that doesn't mean you only have to pray twice. No, they offered it twice daily so the aroma would constantly be there. But my brethren will say, well, I pray before I eat. And they had to think about it. I pray before a meal. I pray before I put my kids to bed.
That's about it.
Is that it? Is that all that we pray? Is that all the incense that we burn? My brethren, and sometimes me, burn so little incense of prayer that God has forgotten what we smell like. We're keeping the incense burning so He can have the aroma of our prayers in His nostrils. Don't cease to pray. Come on, priest. Pray. Number four, then we're done. To back up. God's priests had to be washed lest they die. Before even entering the tabernacle, as I said, the priest had business to perform. If he doesn't wash himself, if he's not ceremonially cleansed, symbolically cleaned, he dies before the Lord. Oh, but it's just symbolism. No, it's not just symbolism. It is symbolism. He's not actually washing away anything off his body but just dirt. But it symbolizes him purifying himself before God so he can go perform God's duties. Washing, anyone want to take a guess, symbolizes baptism. Oh, but it's just symbolic. No, it's not just anything. It's symbolic, yes, but it's not just symbolic. And just as it was then, it's commanded for us now. Listen, critics will argue. Here's the old argument. Well, the priests were priests before they were washed. Therefore, you don't have to be baptized because you're already a priest or you're already a Christian before you're baptized. That is not what the illustration says. That is not what the symbolism symbolizes. A priest was only a priest because he was born a Jew and a Levite. Therefore, he was born first to be a priest. But then once he washes himself, he is born again. Then he can do the work of God. You follow me? I am a person just born in the world, but if I want to be a priest of God in order to do what priests do, which is live and work in the holy place of God, I must be born again. That's John 3:5, which we'll get to in 2 weeks' time in our Sunday morning sermon. Listen, just because a priest was a priest, that's irrelevant to the metaphor. He couldn't do anything. He may as well not be a Levite at all, not be a priest at all if he's not washed. And if he tries to walk in that holy place of God unwashed, sayonara. I have to be washed if I want to go to the holy place of God. Not a building, but the spiritual body of Jesus Christ, Ephesians 1:22 and 23. His holy place over which Christ is high priest. And I serve as a priest. Acts 2:38, Acts 2:47, Ephesians 1:22 and 23. Put them all together. What does it say? If I want to be performing in the body of Christ, the holy place of God, I must be baptized for the remission of my sins, and added to, placed in, the holy place of God. And since there's no salvation without baptism, Galatians 3:26 and 27, and since baptism puts me into Christ, 1 Corinthians 12:13, I must be washed if I want to go into the holy place, lest I die. That makes sense. It makes sense to me. And yet people use the truth to argue lies. Have you been washed? Without it, you can't serve as a priest. Without it, if you die again. Hellfire forever. And like the priests of the Old Testament, they were warned before they approached that altar, make sure you're washed. We warn the world today. Make sure you're washed before you stand before God at judgment. Have you been washed? You can be. Every sin washed away, Acts 22:16. Born again, John 3:5. You can be added to Christ's kingdom, Colossians 1:13. You can be serving God as a priest, 1 Peter 2:5. Have you been doing your duties as a priest? You've been trimming your wicks? You've been carrying the light? Have you been communing with God, praying to God? If you haven't, now's the time. Don't say to yourself, oh, woe is me, I'm stuck in this sin. Just get out of the sin. He's provided the way. It's the holy place of God. Are you in it? Have you walked out of it? Go back to it. If we can help you do those things right now, let us know as we stand and sing.